on this issue of bilateral netting, the government is bringing a bill on bilateral netting of qualified financial contractors. This is absolutely critical for financial stability in this country. So, very many members have spoken on what exactly that this bill is bringing in. I'd like to repeat some of the fundamental points related to this bill. This bill actually brings in a firm legal basis for bilateral netting between two counterparties. Why only bilateral? Why not multilateral? And what exactly does this entail in the name of bilateral? I'd like to just elaborate on that for a minute, sir. Multilateral netting is already taken care of. Multilateral financial contracts, you have a Clearing Corporation of India, for example, acts as a mediator, and therefore it's a multilateral contract regulator, manager, and so on. The Clearing Corporation of India acts as a buyer to a seller and as a seller to a buyer, thereby minimizing counterparty default risks. And netting, as opposed to grossing, in the case of multilateral contracts, is already available through the Payments and Settlement Systems Act of 2007, which is, and under the, also the SEBI regulations. So the SEBI regulations take care of regulating them. The Payments and Systems Settlement Systems Act 2007 is already in place. So in a way, multilateral financial contracts have a system and a legal framework available. It is just the bilateral ones which do not have any legal firm basis. Just let us see what is the volume of bilateral financial contracts in this country, sir. An estimation which was done by the Clearing Corporation of India places the value of bilateral derivative contracts, which is non-centrally cleared, those which are non-centrally cleared, bilateral derivative contracts are reported to be, and this is an estimate, are reported to be about 56,33,257 crores as of 2018 March. That's the volume of bilateral derivative contracts, and this is an estimate done by the Clearing Corporation of India. Clearing Corporation of India, which deals with the multilateral financial contracts, but only the bilateral ones is estimated to be 56,33,257 crores as of March 18. It is also estimated that about 40% of the total derivative transactions in India are non-centrally cleared, and the rest, 60%, is centrally cleared or multilateral derivatives contracts. In other words, the share of multilateral derivative contracts in total financial contracts is about 60%, and bilateral ones are 40% of the total financial contracts. So here, whilst recognizing the chunk of bilateral contracts and therefore the importance for the need for, necessity for a frame legal basis is established, but I would want to underline the historical importance of this one, in the sense this is an exercise which all of us are engaging in getting a legal basis for bilateral netting because of the lessons learned from the global financial crisis of 2008. The global financial crisis of 2008, as you know, then there was no COVID, but it shook the entire world. The global financial crisis of 2008 shook the entire world, even India suffered under it, and it raised a lot of questions on the role which has been played by the OTC derivatives in accentuating the crisis. So the global financial crisis had a very strong, if you can recognize, a very strong influence played by these kind of derivatives, which probably were less regulated. The derivative markets can facilitate excessive and opaque risk-taking, which may lead to a lot of systemic risks. As a result, three concerns emerged. The G20 countries also called for an international standard setting bodies to reform this entire derivative markets. The major reform measures implemented in this regard since after the 2008 global crisis are: one, standardized OTC derivatives should be traded on exchanges or electronic platforms wherever they are appropriate. The second one was all standardized OTC derivatives should be cleared through a central counterparties, which is what the Clearing Corporation of India is. So three lessons were learned. The first one was all standardized OTC derivatives should be traded on exchanges or on electronic platforms where appropriate. That was the first lesson we learned. The second lesson we learned was all standardized OTC derivatives should be cleared through a central counterparty, which is the CCP, which is the Clearing Corporation for us. Third one, sir, and that is what is more important and relevant for this bill here, the third one is the non-centrally cleared derivatives, which is in a way the bilateral derivatives. The non-centrally cleared derivatives should be subjected to higher capital requirements. And also these derivatives should attract margin requirements. So this meant banks had to keep a higher margin locked up just to meet the risk of such exchanges which are not centrally cleared. So for those derivative exchanges which are not getting centrally cleared, banks ended up keeping more money to meet the risk in a locked up kind of a format, and that money which is kept locked up, which was ballooning, was not even available for lending and other activities of the bank. And therefore, the RBI in India on 1st September 2016 came up after due consultation with a draft regulation, which was then named as Variation Margin RBI Direction, which was a draft document which was put out by the RBI for consultation. Consultations were held, but unfortunately it couldn't see the light of the day because there was no legislative backing available. Since after 2016, again the RBI has now come up sometime on the 7th of September 2020 with another draft of such a regulation which can regulate all the bilateral netting matters, and that also is awaiting a legislative backing. And today we are discussing on the legislative backing. Just so the lessons learned from the global financial crisis, three of them, first two have been addressed, the third one waits a legislative backing, and therefore today if we pass it, that legislative backing can be provided, and therefore then it can help us to save quite a few money, which otherwise the banks are expected to keep in a locked up mode. And therefore, to that extent, credit capital remains unutilized or it remains denied. Just to give you an idea, sir, now after passing the bill, we went back to assess, in case the act was available earlier, how much of money would have been available with the banks for onward lending without getting locked up in an unproductive way in the name of keeping it for the gross system with which netting is done and not margin system in which it should be done. If only this law was available even in 2017, 42,194 crores would have been available with the banks for credit onward lending. Whereas, because this act was not available, 42,194 crores were kept locked up and it wasn't available at all, which was not necessary if only the bilateral netting had happened. Instead of calculating on gross basis, if we had calculated the values in net basis, this is the kind of money banks did not have to keep locked up to face any eventual risk. Again, in 2018, if this law was available even in 2018, 45,956 crores would have been available for credit lending. In 2019, 67,792 crores would have been available. And today, March 2020, if I take the figures, 58,308 crores are locked up because we don't have a law for bilateral netting. This figure, this set of figures that I've given you now, is on the basis of the actual data collected from 31 private, public and foreign banks all put together for India. So just imagine the ballooning requirement for banks to keep aside that kind of money just because we don't have a law in this country to authorize the regulators for bilateral netting out rather than grossing out. So when two parties, if I have to very, very simply put it, sir, if two parties are engaging in a contract, one has to pay the other 100 rupees, the other had to pay 210 rupees, the end of the day, only 110 rupees will have to be exchanged because this and that would be netted out. Whereas now what happens is this one keeps aside for the 100 rupees and that one keeps aside for 210 rupees. End of the day, everybody is calculating risk on the basis of what they are facing rather than netting what exactly the financial market will face. And end of the day, everybody is locking more money for just facing risk. So this particular legislation that we are engaging in is so necessary for the stability of the financial market. Otherwise, banks, each one of them, are locking up money, and that money is not available for our economic activity. End of the day, locked up money remains locked up. Economy is starved of funds. If the lesson enhances liquidity into the market, and therefore what happens is economy gets greater lubrication to move rather than sit and wait for that locked up assets to get released. So these are the essential points, sir. I would just highlight that the benefits that the country will derive from this exercise would be, the financial sector would be greater resilient for this particular act which is coming in. Second, it will reduce the price of derivative products on account of optimal utilization of all the capital which will be available, and enable banks to increase credit limits because they'll have more money now. They will have greater credit limits for counterparties and clients. Then Honourable Member Suresh Prabhu raised this point. Corporate bond markets will get energised. India is in the process of, in fact, Suresh Prabhuji asks for a roadmap, which in a way I have mentioned during my budget speech. So corporate bond markets will be greatly energised because the credit default swap markets will be better functioning now. And finally, sir, business exits also will be having better recovery. Business exits will be better because improved recovery mechanisms will happen for financial contracts. To that extent, the IBC also will have a bearing in that this particular legislation will have a, to that limited extent, a supersedence over the IBC itself. So there are one or two other points which I would like to highlight. This bilateral netting legislation will help us in evaluating risks far more in real-time basis, and actual risk assessment happens rather than a notional risk assessment based on the gross figures. It is the net which is important, otherwise the real value of money is locked up. So with largely these kind of benefits which are so clearly standing out, it's important for us to recognize how much of a milestone this legislation, if passed today, will have. So one or two points which is specifically raised by Suresh Prabhuji was that, will individuals be affected? Will you be micromanaging it? He's a very qualified chartered accountant and also knows quite a few things about financial market. He raised this very important point. I respect him for that. The individual is eligible for netting benefits. But however, the counterparty to such transaction must be an entity regulated by the authority who's enlisted in the first schedule of the bill. In other words, a bilateral financial contract entered between the two individuals is not per se eligible, but for netting, and other counterparty must be a regulated entity. And that list is very clearly given by us in the schedule itself. So what kind of things are covered under this bill and what are not covered? With that, I will conclude, sir. The bill covers financial contracts which are entered into on a bilateral basis, which is outside of the clearing system. This bill will empower financial regulators, that is RBI, SEBI, IRDAI, PFRDA, which is the Provident Fund Regulatory, IFSC, all authorities who we mentioned in the Schedule 1 of this Act. They will be notifying the contract under its purview as qualified financial contractor. So typically, the types of trades that are negotiated bilaterally, which will get included here, are swaps, forwards, and certain complex options. So some of the contracts which are going to get covered under the bill are cross-currency or interest rate swaps or commodity swaps, spot, future, or forward foreign exchange transaction gets covered here. Currency or interest rate, future or option gets covered here. Credit derivatives such as the credit default swap gets covered here. Very important in today's global strategy and economy. Commodity derivatives such as electricity derivatives, oil derivatives, coal derivatives, or gas derivatives get also covered. Sir, with this just one bullet which I'm telling you, commodity derivatives such as electricity derivatives, oil derivatives, coal derivatives, or gas derivatives, you can immediately imagine what are the kind of transactions which are going to get covered because of this legislation that this House is choosing to consider today. This bill, if passed, will have a very big bearing on the financial stability of India, and we'll have a buoyant bond market, as a result of which businesses will have greater affordable resources, and therefore I would strongly recommend that this House consider passing this bill, and I thank you for the support extended, sir.
Thank you, Madam Minister.